When you fill it with positive thoughts, your life will start to change. I, Ria Sharma, student manager of BIMHRD, feels deeply honored to welcome Mr. S. Varadaratan amongst us today. S. Varadaratan, or Raja, as he is popularly known, is an alumnus of Xavier Labor Relations Institute, XLRI, Jamshedpur, and Indian Society for Training and Development, New Delhi. He is a graduate in Leadership and Life Coach from Coach for Life, USA, and a Hogan Certified Professional. He has over 3 decades of experience as a human resource leader who has shaped his performing cultures at major growth brands with technical business acumen, prolific communication, and robust development programs. He prides himself for working in partnership with senior management to orchestrate cultural development and organization change initiatives that address corporate goals and strategies. He has received a great deal of industry-wide recognition during his career, some of them being awarded the seasoned HR Professional Award from NHRDN, the best HR professional by the World HR Congress, and featuring in the list of top 100 most talented HR professionals by World HRD Congress. Currently, he is a strategy and talent enabler, life and leadership coach. Prior to this, he was associated with Tata Sia Airlines Ltd, Vistara, a joint venture between Tata Sons and Singapore Airlines, as a CHRO and head of corporate affairs. Before this, he was executive president, human resource of Tata Teleservices Ltd. He was also a member of the Tata Group Employee Relation Council and was an invitee to the Tata Sia Board. Besides the Tata Group, Spectra Mind and Quattro, he has worked and made significant contributions in organization building, performance management, remuneration practices, and career development for organizations like American Express International, Asian and South Asia region, KPMG Peak Marwick in Muscat, Price Waterhouse in India, Sundaram Clayton, and McDowell's UB Group. Sir, I welcome you with full exuberance and reverence. May I now request you to enlighten with your words of wisdom. The podium is all yours, sir.
Good afternoon. It's wonderful to be here, and I was wondering who she was talking about. I have been associated and coming to this institute since 1998. Don't ask me my age. I've been here, I know Professor Bala for a long time, and it's always been my pleasure to be here and meet the students. Because more than what I share with the students, I learn a lot from each one of you. So hopefully today also will be no different, and I will learn a lot more from each one of you by the time I leave this room. So to that extent, I'm going to let the floor open for a lot of questions after I share some basic thoughts on why I'm here. Now you are going to hear a lot of things about what's happening in HR, what's happening in business, what is happening with the millennials like you, and what's happening in the corporates to face what's happening in the world today. The world is going through tremendous change. I don't need to share about that. You're going to learn about this from everyone else. I'm not going to talk about it. I'm only going to give a preface of what the world is going through before I come to what I think will be useful to each one of us. Some of the things which are happening in the corporate world, which started about a couple of years ago, is digitization, which is a big thing which is happening to the corporate world and changing everything in the corporate world. Be it big data analytics, be it the cloud computing, be it the way people look at the social media, and everything is controlled by digitization. So that's going to make a very, very big impact on each one of you when you get into your working life. But at the same time, why is digitization so important? It's because there is a need to simplify what's happening around us. We human beings are extremely famous for making simple things complex. Many scientists came into this world by making simple things complex. Many people became famous because of they made very simple things complex. So how do you simplify things the way it works so that everyone can manage to do it the way, same way as everyone else around and standardize things? People are no longer talking about employee engagement in the workplace. Gone are the days of employee engagement. People are talking about what is the employee experience we are creating for our employees, the experience in terms of physical experience, the terms of mental experience, the term of job experience. So experiencing is what is people are looking at. While it remains EE, it's not employee engagement but employee experience. A lot of people keep talking about the VUCA world. I'm sure over the last 2 days, at least 3 speakers spoke about VUCA.
Yes, sir.
So why should I not speak about VUCA? Okay, what is VUCA? Let me see. What is VUCA?
Volatile, uncertain.
One by one. V. I'll ask this side. V. Volatile. U.
Uncertain.
C. And A. I have a different meaning for VUCA. It's not this. Most of us are getting stuck with this and say, and we are so afraid of VUCA. But VUCA in my vocabulary is, V is for visioning. Companies which are able to have a clear vision and explain it very clearly to people were able to take their companies to newer heights. So V is for visioning. U is for understanding. How well you understand your customers, how well you understand your employees, how well you understand your products, and how well you understand your competition. Basic understanding at the word, simple word understanding is what the U represents. C, coming from visioning and understanding is clarity. How clear are we, how logical are we in the way we look at things. And lastly, A, anyone want to guess on what A is?
Adaptability.
Attitude.
Application.
A combination of action, ability, combination of these two. Agility. How agile are companies today, or how agile are individually we today, is what a VUCA world is all about. So if you are able to manage this, VUCA is, you don't need to fear about VUCA. Again, I was saying, simple things made complex. That is, VUCA is one word which is making everyone sit back and, you know, be afraid of. Now, if I want to look at the world which you are going through, lots of new behaviors are coming. For example, people who are talking to you about millennials. Communication, the way people communicate have changed. I don't know whether you are allowed to bring in your phones into this auditorium or not.
No?
Very sad. I would have loved you to tweet about what was happening here today. Sad. I'll speak to Professor Bala for sure on this.
Yes?
But let me ask you, how are we to ensure that each one of you will only use it for the right purpose and not keep tweeting or taking photographs and sending something outside? That's the trouble which organizations are going through. While they opened up their networks to people, they also have to build systems in such a way that they cannot afford their company secrets to go out or their company confidentiality to go out. So the HR people face a major issue, because for someone is pulled up for something, before it hits the neighbor in the office, it has hit the world. There is an organization in India which actually measures the HR performance by seeing how much of positivity is there in Glassdoor on the company rather than on the employee's performance in the company. That's the power of social media today. So new organizations have to ensure that they act differently, behave differently. Technology, I spoke about digitalization, that's going to be a major change. Mobility. It's now not, people don't go to offices anymore.
Many of them work from home, work from anywhere. So working from anywhere at any time is becoming a norm in many organizations. So how do you create a culture in the organization? How do you create employee experiences for such an environment? And globalization is never far behind. We change something here, something changes globally, we change again. So I always keep saying this, geography is now history. Because there's no boundaries dividing us from what's happening in the US. What comes as a cereal in the US comes here the next day, or sometimes the same day. So the geography is no longer an issue. With all this, what has HR got to do in 2025 is what I look at. If I look at a vision and say, okay, this is what HR needs to be in 2025, how many people here are HR students? Okay? How many people are non-HR students? I'm really sorry. You guys have no choice but to be an HR person. When you join an organization, you're going to be people managers. You have no choice. I believe that every manager in an organization is an HR manager. The day we stop thinking as HR as a function and start thinking of HR as a philosophy, every organization will grow in this country. So each one of you will play the role of HR in your own small teams. You will be responsible for their employee experience. You will be responsible for their performance. You will be responsible for the development. So now let me ask you, how many HR people are there in this room now? Still a lot of people are not convinced. You'll get convinced as soon as you reach a corporate world. It'll be a hard shock, but you'll be convinced. You need to understand the customers. It's told everywhere. You need to understand customers. But what's necessary for HR is to create systems which will meet the customer's demand, not the internal customer's demand. I always keep saying that internal customers are only a means. The end is the external customer. If you're going to be so different in what we are doing, why does HR fail? This is a quote which I read somewhere. HR does not fail because they do wrong things. They fail because they continue to do what needs to be the right things for too long. They continue to do the same thing over and over and over again. Why? Because they are comfortable in doing it. Each one of you here have a comfort zone. Yes or no?
Yes.
So, what I want to talk today is how can you go and step beyond your comfort zone? Because that is what is going to make you a successful person. Whether you are a professional, HR professional, marketing professional, finance professional, system professional, your success will depend upon how well you are able to step out of your comfort zone. So if I were to look at what a comfort zone, technical definition of comfort zone are the activities and behaviors which fit a routine pattern that minimizes stress and risk. So if you have been doing something regularly and you have been successful in that, or for example, there are people who get up in the morning, the first thing is they have to drink water and then brush teeth. There are some people who get up and they have to read a newspaper before they can do anything else. There are some people who have to go into a bath before they can do anything else. My son, who's 22 now, when he was in school, you wake him up, he'll say 2 minutes. I think Maggie was created because of him. Every 2 minutes I had to wake him up. After about 7 minutes he'll wake up, he'll walk like a zombie into the bathroom, stand under a shower, and then only he'll talk. So that was his routine. That was his comfort zone. He cannot be awake till he walks into a shower. Now, all of us have some comfort zones. Even in, for example, at work, we have to take the same route to work. How many people of you get out of the bed at the same side of bed? You have no choice. The other side is taken by someone else. Or the wall. You can get into the wall as well. However, what I'm trying to say is that such behaviors over a period of time becomes your comfort behavior. So how do you get out of it? Because if you have to perform differently, perform, you have heard of out-of-box performance, is you have to step out. And there is something, why are we all so afraid? Okay, if I ask you to make a presentation here, come up to the stage and make a presentation, how many people will be able to do it ready? Even with those who lifted their hands right now and said, we'll readily be able to do it, when you get onto stage after a well-prepared speech, do you still have some tension in the bottom of your stomach?
Yes, sir.
That's called butterflies in the stomach?
Yes.
That is what makes people perform at a different level. I call it personal optimal anxiety. It's basically my anxiety. You need to have anxiety to perform well. It has to be optimal levels. It should not be over anxious. If you are very anxious, you'll fail. If you're less anxious, you'll become overconfident. So there's an optimal level of anxiety for you to get out of your comfort zone. Each one of us have it in us. Only thing is, we have not tested it. So people may ask, why should I be outside the comfort zone? I'm very happy with what I am. I have been like that. I come from a middle class family. I was born and brought up in Chennai. Went to a nice college, Vivekananda College, for people who know. It's an RK Mission college. Very pious college. It was an all boys college. No risk, no comfort. Go there, come back. Study, come back. If it is a festival day, it's a holiday. If there is some other Hindu festival, 2 hours late classes. So it was very comfortable. And everyone from the college went to do their CA. I was a BCom student. Everyone went for CA or a cost accounting. Here I was. Someone told me, try MBA. So I went for MBA, and that was out of my comfort zone. Because I didn't know what MBA was. So the first step which I took was, okay, let me write an exam. I wrote my exam and got through. And the next part of my comfort zone out was, many of you here are going through that, first time outside home.
Yes, sir.
I've always been born and brought up in Chennai. I went to a new place, Jamshedpur. I didn't know a word of Hindi. The only Hindi I knew was, hi, naam kya hai? Those are the only two things I know. So everyone I used to ask, naam kya hai? Even after he gave the name, I used to ask the same thing again. It was so bad. And here I was in a Jamshedpur, away from home, and that again built a resistance in me, and I learned. So if I would ask whether I would have done better if I stayed back in Chennai, maybe. But getting out of my comfort zone did help me. Then I went and joined a liquor company, McDowell's. I come from a pure Brahmin family. I remain a teetotaler, maybe that's why. I know what they manufacture. So people say, how are you joining this company? But my growth in professional life happened because of my stepping out again of the comfort zone and saying, I will not join a traditional organization, let me join this company. So why do you think it's good to be outside the comfort zone? Let me ask for a few volunteers to talk about why do you think it should be good to be outside the comfort zone? Anyone here? Learn to adapt. You become more adaptable, you're more accepting change, and you become more productive that way. So that is one way. So it's easier to deal with unexpected changes. Thank you. Any other thought? Someone said challenges. Yes, same thing. Adaptability to meet challenges.
Sir.
Learn to think on your feet.
Think on your feet.
Lovely. It actually activates your brains because you are able to think on your feet and adapt yourself to the situation you are in, and it brings out the best in you. So it's easier to push your boundaries by being out of the comfort zone. And everyone keeps talking about innovation and creativity. Unless you step out of your comfort zone, you will not be able to be creative and innovative, because it is doing something out of the box. So people say, okay, how can you do the car? How can you work outside the comfort zone? For anything, like anything,
If you have to work outside the comfort zone, you have to take your first step. If you don't experiment, if you don't take your first step, you will never be able to get out of the comfort zone. For example, you have, from tomorrow, take any habit of yours and do it the reverse. For example, I know people who brush up, down first, this way next, and then inside. Change it and see. In small, small things, try to do things differently. You will make a fool of yourself. But it's okay. Because I always keep saying, when you make a fool of yourself and fall down flat on your face, you cover more ground in that experience. Rather than walking 5 steps, if you fall down, you are covered 5 feet or 6 feet to your height as per a height, and you get up in a different place with much more learning. So take the first step. If you don't take the first step, you'll never be able to get out of the comfort zone. And that's something which you need to do. What is the worst thing that can happen when you make a failure or when you make a first step? You'll fail. So what? Have not each one of us failed? I have failed. You know, I used to play for the state in cricket and tennis at one point of time. But till the time I reached there, I have failed miserably in my school. I was not selected for the cricket team. But over a period of time, look, I'm talking in past tense. I don't play cricket anymore. Okay, don't look at me and say, this man? No. Okay? I used to represent Bihar in cricket and Bihar in tennis. Now, what's the worst thing that can happen? You'll fail. But that failure will teach you. We have read about multiple stories about how people tried again and got successful. So there is nothing wrong. Don't pick a safe choice. Don't pick a safe choice. Try the difficult things. You will get it. Most of us don't try because we don't want to face our fears. Each one of us have fears. Face your fears. For example, if people can't talk in public, make it a point to get up in front of the class and talk, because that's a known audience to you. You can make a fool of yourself and then still get practice in that. Expand your comfort zone. That is how you expand your comfort zone. Take risks. How many people here take risks? Generally. Look, be ready. I'll ask you what risk you took. Now tell me, how many people have taken risks?
My name is Ashish, and coming to my decision coming to this college was.
Wow!
And I'm still living it.
Mr. Gopal Krishna, you're not supposed to listen to this. More than the risk of coming to this college, what you spoke now is much more riskier.
That's why I said I'm still living it, and hopefully I'll live it well.
So, this risk, was it worth it or not?
I guess yes, it is.
You guess it is, so you're still not, you're still living it.
I've only completed a couple of months over here. So.
Okay, you're in the first year.
Yeah.
Okay, so you have taken the risk and you're feeling, you don't feel negative about it.
No, not at all.
Give him a big round of applause.
Thank you.
Not only for taking the risk to come here, but taking the risk to share it with everyone. Now, one of the things which always happens is, if you start accepting failures as a part of life, you will take risks. The day you stop accepting failures, you will not be able to take risks anymore because you'll play it really safe. For example, people go for? People play cards here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You play for money or no?
Yes,
sir. Sir, close your ears. You play for money or not?
Yes, sir.
How many yeses? I play for money, boss.
Yes, sir.
Even in college, I used to earn my mess bills out of that. Okay. Now, as long as you play for fun, and as long as you don't see it, there are some people who say, I have to gain today. You lose your interest in the game. You don't take the risk anymore, because then after that you play safe. teen pati, you'll keep dropping it. You won't even play. You won't take the risk. You won't play blind. Rami, you will not bluff. So, to that extent, as long as you accept failure and you have no attachment to the gain or loss of it. If you gain, you gain. For example, he came here. When he took the risk to come here, he didn't know whether it would be good or bad. So he took that neutral view, and that is what will make you a better person. How many people stay in the hostel? First years all stay in the hostel, right? Oh, first years also stay outside. Nice. Now, from wherever you live, coming to the classes, do you take the same room? Every day? I hear yeses and noes. How many yeses? Who take the same route every day? Great. One thing for each one of you doing the same thing. Please change your route. You will not get lost, don't worry. You'll find your way back. If you're in the hostel, instead of going through this door, go through this door. And that's a simple change. I think our mindset is, we'll do the same thing over and over again. We don't want to think differently. I'm asking you to think differently in small things which you do. Small things which you do on a daily basis, try to change. And that is one thing which will help you come out of your comfort zone. Okay, let me ask you the other thing. How many people, for taking a decision, think a lot before taking the decision?
Yes, sir.
Okay? How many people take decisions like this? Okay, the challenge for you guys is, from tomorrow, the people who are taking a lot of time to take decisions will take snap decisions. Take decisions like that. Don't think too much. The guys who are taking decisions like this, take some amount of time and take a decision. Look, our mindset, I always say that snap decisions are people who have gut feel. Intuitive. I have intuition, I think this will be right. And I'll go with it. I'm not saying it's wrong. At the same time, the other people who are thinking along before taking decisions, also they're not right, wrong. They are taking time, analyzing various alternatives. But for a change, try to go with your gut feel. See what happens. So what is the worst thing which can happen here? You'll fail. Try, it's okay. Gut feel is something which you should try. How do you get out of your comfort zone? Many a times when people ask you saying, "Will you like to do this for me?" The first answer is no, I can't do it. Try saying yes more often. Say, for example, someone is going on a trekking expedition and he's saying, "Yeah, you want to come?" Say yes and see what happens. Or someone is going to a bar. Oh, I'm sorry, I shouldn't be talking about that here. Okay. Someone is going out to a restaurant. And you don't want to go. Say yes and see what happens. Yes? Okay, great. Come with me tonight. I am a teetotaler, I'm sorry. Okay. You have to enjoy the unknown. You have to push yourself. For example, I always give this example for pushing yourself. There are guys who want to speak to some girls and ask them out. They're extremely scared to step out of their comfort zone. Similarly, there are girls who want to ask a guy out. Try asking. What is the worst thing that can happen? What is the worst thing that happens? You'll get hit. But I'm not even saying for a moment that intentions are wrong. I'm saying you can get to know a person, ask out. I think it's, you know, all of us have been brought up in a culture saying that you can do some things, you cannot do some things. Try to be different.
try to think outside the box. How many people travel by flights to come to Pune? Okay? Now, if you are traveling by a full service airline, have you ever tried to ask for an upgrade? Okay, there's one hand I can see. Many of us don't want to do it. We just go to the economy class and say, okay, let me book in and go. Ask, you may get it. International flights, I have gone and asked and got upgrades to business class. Yeah, you may say I'm lucky. But I was lucky because I asked. It's a risk which I took. If I had not taken the risk and said, this guy, what is this guy think of me if I go and ask him for an upgrade? I bought an economy class ticket, but I'm asking for business class. Don't. I think what you need to do is take that extra risk in you to get out of your comfort zone. Otherwise, you'll always remain in a comfort zone. Remember, today is gone. Tomorrow is a new day. You can ask. There's nothing wrong in you trying. And how does these things help? It helps in newness. It helps you explore new things. It helps you experience new things. It helps you, as someone said, better equipped to manage the constant changes which is happening around us in this world. Over a period of time, you'll find that your intuition and your decision making starts getting aligned. I'm telling you, I've been in the corporate world now for 35 years. Most of my decisions are gut feel decisions. And what do? I take the decision in my mind and say, okay, this is the decision, let me test the hypothesis. And whatever I test as hypothesis or analysis is around the decision, whether it's going to work or not. If it doesn't work, I throw it out. If it works, I go with it. It saves me a lot of mental agony and time. And it saves my team a lot of time. So I encourage each one of my team members to think intuitively and go with the gut feel. You can never go wrong. Your confidence goes up. You all feel elated about it. You say, wow, I did it. Creativity juices start flowing. You start thinking outside the box. You start moving out of your comfort zones. You start performing much better. I have seen people perform better. I can feel for myself and say for myself, I have done better because I took those risks. You know, I was talking about asking a girl out or a boy out. I asked my friend's sister whether she likes me and we'd like to get married. And we got married. I took this risk. The risk was, one, I lose my friendship with my friend, he was my best friend. Second was, being a real Brahmin community, what the people will think about me. This man is atrocious is what I thought my would-be father-in-law and mother-in-law think of me. But the girl accepted, I accepted, and then we went to our parents and they accepted. So I had to step out of my comfort zone of that so-called Brahmin mentality of mine. I'm sorry to be parochial here, but I'm talking about myself and not about someone else. So I was able to get it. So I'm saying, taking the risk, you feel the benefit of it. And I'm living in the same way for the last 35 years. Okay. I also think the last thing which I want to say in our comfort zone is, once you start seeing failure as learning, you are a very happy person. And another thing which I should advise each and every one of you, don't be serious all the time. Learn to laugh at yourself. Many a times we do not laugh at ourselves. We think that we are God's gift to mankind. We are superman, superwoman. I cannot make a mistake. I cannot do this. Laugh at yourself. Yeah. And once you start laughing at yourself, one thing happens. Even when someone else laughs at you, you don't bother. So you start accepting yourself, number one. Number two is, there's one more tip which I give when people become very angry with people or angry with yourself. Try this out and you will succeed. 100% succeed. Close your eyes and give a big smile for 10 seconds. Anytime you're angry or upset,
If you're angry saying that what is this old man talking about comfort zone now, close your eyes, give a big smile for 10 seconds. Your anger will go down automatically, your mindset will change automatically. I have tried this very successfully. I tried it with all my mentees. I coach a lot of people and this works. Before I conclude, I want to bring it back and say, what is in it? What is in it for people? And how can people, especially students who are getting into the corporate world, I call it the Ignite. Ignite for short. The first thing is I need each one of you to let go and imagine how the future is going to be and live your imagination. Disney would not have been formed if someone didn't imagine Disney. Pixar would not have been formed if someone did not imagine. An Apple or an iPad or an iPhone wouldn't have come if someone had not imagined. So imagination is the key for you to succeed in your life and go beyond the comfort zone. G, whatever levels of achievement you reach, stay grounded. When I say stay grounded, be practical, be realistic. It's very easy based on imagination to fly elsewhere. But be grounded in what you do. And that's a reality check which you always keep to look at. N, increase your networking capability. Lot of things in life happen through relationships and networks. It may not happen through your jank presentations. It will happen through relationships and networks. So remember, this network of students here are going to help you through my life. I'm still in a network with my own classmates from Excel. And if I need something, I just pick up the phone and call and I get things done. And each one of you will have built up that relationship here to be feeling free to call each other. I would say that that's going to be one very critical path for success. Next I is always being inquisitive. Learning should never stop. Being inquisitive will always help you. Be curious to learn anything and everything. For me, technology came to me thanks to my sons. My digitalization experience is because of my sons. Because if I had to cope up with them, I had to learn. And it's necessary for us to continue learning till we die. Key, the tenacity. How perseverant you are, how focused you are, how tenacious you are is going to make the difference between success and failure. And last E, guys, don't have such glum faces. Enjoy, live your life. You live only once. We are not cats to live nine lives. Have fun. Freak out. You can enjoy every day at work, at play, at college, at home, anywhere. That enjoyment is what will keep you young. That enjoyment is what will keep you going. And I enjoy every day, and that's why I'm here. And I would like to open for questions. You can ask anything. Don't restrict it to what I spoke today. You can ask anything under the sun, including my weight. Go ahead. Look, the biggest issue which I have seen many HR people have is that they always think they are a support function. I never saw myself as a support function, I saw myself as a line function. I always partnered with my business to say what is best for them. I'll give examples. When I became an entrepreneur and we started a BPO company called Spectrum, and which later Wipro purchased from us, I was HR only portion of what I did. I first thing which I always ask every HR person to do is not think HR but think business. Understand the business from scratch. I could talk technology, I could talk outsourcing. When I was in telecom, I could talk telecom better than the business person. In fact, I was talking so well about telecom, they wanted me to lead the company in telecom. And I refused and said, no, I want to be in HR. So the first learning for me was that you need to understand business from scratch. And you need to think like the back of your hand. And next thing you should say is, what can I do to improve the capability of human resources or people in the organization to meet the business goals? So I don't think myself as a business partner, I think myself as a business integrator. What can I do with people and their capability to meet the business goals? And if you talk this language, you are not seen as a support function anymore. You are seen as a line function. Decisions were taken to expand business based on my inputs. I used to sit in the meeting along with my CEO and CFO, and we used to take the decisions. So I think it's necessary for us to think first, stop thinking that we are a support function. You can lead the company's thoughts. So to that extent, that is my response to you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, in an interview, personal interview, that normally HR asks a question that what's your plan for down the line for 5 years? Normally, these students prepare for it. So at that time, whether we will give answer in a normal way or we will prepare for it.
What do you think we should do?
I think so. At that time, whatever will come at that moment, we should say.
No. I agree that we should say what you are spontaneously coming to your mind. But at the same time, remember you are in an organization and the organization is expecting something from you. Right? So you need to understand what the organization is going through before you go for an interview and where they are going. And if you are able to tie up what you are spontaneously bringing out from a subconscious mind of what knowledge of the company, and talk in terms of how you can work towards that, because whatever you want to achieve in 5 years time, if it means good for the organization's journey also, then you have succeeded in what you're doing. But for a moment, I'm not saying try to cook up a story to talk about your 5 years. It should be a combination of what you really want to do and what you will do which will benefit the organization in 5 years time. Many a times I go to the interview and say 5 years, that's too long a time for me to think. I'll say I can tell you what I want to do in 2 years time. I'll take, you can change it the way you want it. You have to lead the interviewer to you. Say that I think only in short term, because you know the VUCA world. Throw the same words back to the interviewer. You know the VUCA world, things are changing so fast. You can't actually plan for 5 years. Next 2 years, this is what I want to do. That will be a more impressive response from you rather than cook up an answer.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Here.
Yeah, okay. She has an advantage with the mic.
You just mentioned about us getting out of our comfort zone. So, which is very right. If we look on that point of view, we do need to get out of our cocoon and then go. But as students, if we take too many risks, like it just takes one situation to get out of the comfort zone and then there's no looking back. Then you would risk taking unnecessary risks. So do you think there's a thin line between taking unnecessary risks and actually getting out of the comfort zone?
How do you know it's unnecessary? Give me an example if you want about taking unnecessary risks. Can be any example. Gopal is not there. Oh, he's here.
At times, because there is a certain generation gap, you have a lot of friction with your parents. I'm just taking an example.
Okay, good.
You have a lot of friction with your parents. And many a times, you feel you are right and your parents feel they are right. Whereas you both are right in your own perspective. So at that point of time, you end up saying things that is not required. But it is actually, from your point of view, it is very much needed to establish so and so things. But it might just backfire on me. Like, I'll give a very small example.
Go ahead.
I can't think of a bigger example.
Okay, I'll tell you what. I face this with my sons all the way. You're talking it from the point of view of you telling your parents. I talk it from the point of what I need to tell my sons. Look, many a times, when you start looking at taking risks is not to not say what is there in your mind, but saying it in a way it will be acceptable to you. For example, if I keep saying, I say, no, you can't do it. My son will say, dash, dash, and walk off. Right? But if you're able to explain the logic to the person on why you're saying it, and then say, you take the call. I've done that many times. He'll say, I want to do this. Rather than me saying no, I will just explain things why I believe that it will not work out, and say, you take the call, Aditya, whatever you want to do. The onus was put on the other person. Automatically, the person's mindset is different. Similarly, if you want to do it with your parents, my son does it very often. He'll say, you know, Dad, this is what I want to do. He says that these are the things why I decided I want to do this. Now, you decide and let me know. Over. You have de-risked yourself by saying what you wanted to say. You have taken the risk, but you have de-risked by giving the decision making to the parent. I will think 150 times before saying no to him. Because there's a logic which is given to me, and I have to have a better logic than that to say no. So you're not taking a risk there. You're only trying to express what you have. What I'm trying to say is, you're first explaining this to your parent itself, you're out of your comfort zone. Otherwise, the usual thing is to say yes to the parent, go behind and curse. Or do things without telling them. So it's better for you to be open and spontaneous, but at the same time, use the other person's viewpoint to get things done. That's how I negotiate as well.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir, and Vijay from BIMHRD. I want to ask, in the recent context of job cuts, everyone cycling people, and you also said that you would always try to improve on the capability of your human resources. So why do you think companies first go for job cuts rather than improving capabilities? Because what I feel is, people or the employees are the ones who run the company. And if you sack them, then how will you build the company or make the company into profits?
I agree 100% with you. This is a comparison. I don't know whether there's one YouTube video which is going around at this point of time talking about leadership. I don't know if you guys have seen it. It says, when you have a problem in the family, do you sack a son or a daughter? You don't. Similarly, why should you sack a person in the company? Great question to ask. This is just because of the mismanagement of the corporates, which leads to such a situation. If you still look at it, for example, I've been in Tata Group for 12 years. Very, very few sackings, but sackings were done. Okay? But there it was because the person's performance or attitude, whatever, was not there. Not because of business. But many organizations in India, I'll also say across the world, more in India, is when they have a problem in their organization and they have lots of money to spare, they throw it at people. They solve problems through more people rather than improving productivity to solve the problem. And when the going gets tough and they don't have enough money, the first thing they see is that for doing this job we have three people, we need only one. So they sack me. If the organization is in the growth path, and if you're able to manage not hiring too many people to manage your growth but improving productivity through growth, then what you're saying will not happen. And that's the philosophy of the management as well. But look, it's a very bad and unfair world out there. It's not fair world at all. So you have to live up to those, what is happening in the world. Because people are hiring in redundancy. They don't need to hire so many people, they hire. Because it's very great to say, I have 15,000 people in my company. Without realizing that you need only 10,000 to run the company. I'll give an example. In Tata Teleservices, when I joined the second time, it was about 12,000 people. We didn't need so many. We needed only 8,000 people. So we actually had to go through a major exercise to reduce the number to 8,000. But we gave every employee an opportunity to prove himself or herself for pitching for a role in the organization. all the 11,000 people went through an interview process with two sets of interviews. So what happens is, organization wants to sack people, but they are giving an opportunity to the employee to prove his or her worth. Once the person was okay to be hired, he is remained. People who did not find a slot, we tried to help them find other companies of Tata Group and outplace them. He couldn't. Only 1,000 people got outplaced, 2,500 lost their jobs. They were adequately compensated. But from the point of view of business, what they did was right, because if they maintained these 2,500 people, the other 10,000 people would have lost their jobs because the company would have closed down. So there's a balance which has to happen between what the business wants and what the employees want. And the role of HR, when someone said this is a staff function, if I had played a line function role, people wouldn't have joined the organization. I would have thought twice before hiring an extra person. Even today, when someone comes to me asking for a role, saying I hire some person, the justification which the person has to give to increase the role, increase the number of people, is very high. So it's a fault of the organization, but also the employees need to keep renewing themselves. If they don't renew themselves, they will not be able to fit into some other role. Look at the changing world. So if you're good in multiple skills, you'll be able to move anywhere rather than stick to one place. So I don't know whether I answered your question directly. It is a balance between what the organization wants and what the employee wants. I cannot ask an organization to say, please keep the employee. So that's the answer I can give you on that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I would like to quote Christopher Columbus here that, you can never cross the ocean unless you have the courage to lose the sight of the shore, unquote. Life is all about taking risks, and there is no better defeat than defeating yourself. Thank you once again, sir, for such a thoughtful session.